Joining us on the line now, Government Peace Panel Chairperson Miriam Coronel Ferrer. Good afternoon, Professor Ferrer.
Good afternoon, Ron.
I would like to ask your reactions on some issues that were raised during the Senate hearing, primarily on the consultations that were supposedly made with the Sultanates. Did the OPAP and the Peace Panel have that consultation with them?
Yes, we did meet with several of the people who were present today at the Senate in different occasions. And what we have to say with regard to the Sulu Sultanate and its different heirs is that on the matter of the Saba claim, that is definitely not within the purview of the peace negotiations. Mm-hmm. Even the MNLF agreement did not have anything to do with the Saba claim, neither the 1976 Tripoli agreement nor the 1996 final peace agreement, first under President Marcos, second under President Ramos, precisely because the agreement has to do with the institution of an autonomous government within certain territories and does not address the matter of the claim to Saba. Neither does it diminish it, nor does it have any capacity to resolve the problem.
I'm just curious, ma'am, how did these consultations take place? What was it, just a one-time consultation? And what were the issues that were raised during those consultations? What were their issues?
Way back in 2011, I personally met with the three brothers, the Kiram brothers, two of whom are unfortunately not anymore with us. They have died in recent years. And one of the concrete agreements there was precisely to be able to recognize their customary role within their respective societies, not only with regard to the Sultanate of Sulu, but also for the other royal houses. And you will find these provisions in the DDL. The matter of respect for customary practices, their specific role, for instance, in alternative dispute resolution, which has been their historical role within their communities. On the that particular meeting with the late Jamalul Kiram II, we discussed the possibility of renovating or, you know, putting up a memorial site on the tombstone of the late sultans, the earlier sultans, but that has been that remains a matter to be arranged with. Initially, I discussed this with the National Historical Commission, but, you know, there are certain requirements to be met, such as the willingness of the local government to continue financing the maintenance of the site. But, you know, when the BBL is passed, that will now properly belong to the responsibility of the Bangsamoro government as well as the local governments there.
Okay, so there seems to be some confusion. Would you know if the heirs of the Sultan and even a spokesperson of the Sultanate of Sulu and Princess Jaisal Karam knew about that meeting and knew about the discussions with the Sultan, the late Sultan?
You know, 2 weeks ago, other members of our panel, Secretary Yasmin Busran Lau and former Secretary Senen Bakani, met with Mr. Ichirani and I think one of the sisters of the late or one of the relatives of the late Sultan Jamalul Kiram III. And we I understand I was in Pikawayan in another consultation that time, but I understand from what they said that they clarified many of the things that are in the BBL. For instance, they did point out that nothing in the BBL changes the name of the Sulu Sea. This is one misinformation that has been going around a lot, repeated in different fora. No change in the name of Sulu Sea. Sulu Sea is still Sulu Sea.
Okay. The general sentiment that we get when we're monitoring the Senate hearing is that the Sultanates still have a lot of issues that they want to raise before the Senate. Now, there was a suggestion for an extended time frame for the BBL to complete the consultation process. Now, with the Peace Panel and even the OPAP willing to talk to them again, but there may be no time for you to probably change and incorporate all the things that they may want to have changed in the BBL, but can a continued consultation take place between them and the OPAP and the Peace Panel?
Well, actually, what was really good about the hearing today is that that kind of a history that not so many people, not so many Filipinos know about has come out and was allowed to, you know, find its find expression through the voices of the different royal houses and sultanates. They are, they continue to be a social force in their respective communities, and that is why the BBL also recognizes their particular role within their respective what they call area of responsibility, or the traditional suzerain claims that they have over different areas of Mindanao. But you know, the law was submitted to Congress in September, and many of the position papers have actually been submitted to Congress as well. Mm-hmm. It is no longer in our hands. It's in the hands of Congress. All of these consultations should redound to very specific provisions that might be added to or put inside the BBL. It is now really up to Congress. It was the BTC also before that was primarily in charge, the Bangtamore Transition Commission, that drafted the law, and they conducted their own consultations. But then it was turned over to Congress, and of course Congress has to follow suit. And I think the House has done its consultations, more than 40 of them, and have invited as well these other the representatives of the different houses, as we see now in the Senate hearing.
Yes.
So it is not really anymore the panel that would have to see through the fruition of this process. It is really Congress that will have to buckle down to work and look at the draft and see what else might be added there.
Right. Well, we have heard Senator Bongbong Marcos in an exasperated tone, somehow repeating himself and saying that the sultanates should have been consulted prior to the drafting of the BBL, and even a comprehensive agrarian comprehensive agreement on the Bangsamoro. But are you somehow concerned with Senator Marcos's sentiment and concerned that the sultanates were?
What they can, I would welcome any recommendation from the Senate to the President, for instance, or to the executive branch as to what policy this country should adopt with regard to the claims of the Sulu Sultanate over Sabah, because that is the core of the problem. It is not for the BBL to define that policy on the matter of Sabah. Sabah to be included in the plebiscite is totally out of the question. Given the status of the fact that it is actually not under the de facto control of the Philippine government, so even the MNLF peace agreements way back in 1976 and in 1996 did not include Sabah, and nothing has changed. And precisely, perhaps it's about time that the Senate actually thinks about crafting a policy that can be adopted for this country on the matter of outstanding claims to Sabah.
But it should not affect the BBL.
Either, both ways. It does not affect, it need not affect the BBL insofar as the claim to Sabah is concerned, but of course, insofar as the Sultanates live in these territories, then certainly they play a role, they can participate.
Professor? Okay, we just got cut off. We'll try to talk to Professor Miriam Coronel Ferrer again for a couple of more questions.